Hello, my name is Robertina Šebjanič, and today I will speak here about underwater, mostly about some species which I was working very deeply along with them, moon jellyfish. But also I will also try to speak about some other projects which they are related to these kind of topics. I'm sorry, I just noticed that this one is cut, so I hope you don't mind. We will navigate with all that also. First of all, I'm super excited to be here at KIKK Festival. It's a really amazing festival. I didn't heard about it before being here, and I hope to come here also as a visitor, because it feels there is lots of interesting topics, things happening all over the day. So I hope you will enjoy also later on all the conference and talks. During my presentation, I will also invite on stage in mid of my talk also my collaborator Slavko Glamočanin, and then he will also add some to the topics which we plan to speak about. As I was mentioning before, for 5 years I was working very deeply involved with the jellyfish. They start to be one of these species which is overtaking all the habitats of the marine life. This means you can find them really high up next to the shores and also very deep in the sea. The numbers are increasing, and this is mostly because us humans, we like to be so present. The fact that we many times forget is that the traffic on the oceans and seas is happening on daily basis in big numbers. These numbers did increase since 50s, like 1950s, it's like 200 more traffic than it was before. So you can just imagine what, not only the traffic, but everything, our technical involvement into the oceans and sea, what is doing this to the organisms and living life, which is being present there. My research, I started to work very deeply in marine station in Izmir in Turkey. So here there are some photos also of me working with scientists and artists in Turkey, where kind of during my residency time, there was in the bay of Izmir a huge jellyfish swarm. So there have been like huge numbers of them. But it was also, what was weird was in February, where it shouldn't be happening that. So we also went to look into different levels, you know, because there is ecological problematics which is happening, and also why something like this occurs, you know. But during the research, working with jellyfish, dealing with that, researching, looking into different levels, also lots of sound art was sound research we did. I came across also some interesting facts. One of them is the one which is here, which is now very blown up and really huge, but actually is like really, really tiny creature. And it's a jellyfish, which is called also immortal jellyfish. It's one of the species which is able to go from adulthood back to the polyp stage. And then it's able to wait till the parameters around it would be again suitable to spring back to the adulthood. So I think that's really remarkable. It's something which in our human society, we try to reach that, you know, with lots of different ways, like with regenerative medicine, with having lots of mythology about immortality, understanding that and so on. So this was like one of the interests which we said, okay, that could be something interesting to involve also into the contextualization of the artwork. And then the second is also the protein, the fluorescent protein from jellyfish is used a lot in medicine for the last 20 years since it was researched, because it's one of the ones which is helping to find us lots of diseases and so on. So what I try to say is like we can take lots of fascination from these kind of animals. Also, we can learn a lot of them. And we also abuse and use them a lot in our daily lives. And with my projects, Aurelia One Plus Hearts, I wanted to speak a lot about these topics, you know, because when you do research, you come a lot on lots of topics, lots of interesting, fascinated facts. And then it's always the question how to show this, you know, how to represent this. What I try to avoid as artists working a lot inside the field of art, science, technology, is I try not to be just doing science communication in sense of just illustrating some fact. But also I try to find some, how to call it, something to be more, to find the imperative, you know, to find something which is also bringing arts, philosophy, science on the same level, you know, and to rethink some facts. Do they are facts even, you know, how to work with that and so on. So with Aurelia, it's actually divided then into two pieces. One artwork is more as an audiovisual performance, where me and Jellyfish, we do audiovisual concert together. And the one which is shown also here in KIKK Festival, it's Aurelia One Plus Hertz Proto Vivo Generator. And it's talking about interactive relationship between the animals, moon jellyfish, and the robot. The human just helped to build that. In this moment, I will also ask Slavko if you join me on the stage. Because, you know, there was lots of research was done also, and we have been trying to rethink. Come here. We have been trying to rethink, you know, on the one hand is this complex conceptual way, what we wanted to show in the piece, and then on the other hand was also how to bring this technologically into gallery. So for this, I was very, very thankful that Slavko was with me on board on that. So I would ask you to speak more about this.
Okay, hello, Tess, can you hear me? Okay, so I'm the more of a technical consultant on this project. As Robertina approached me, the idea was to get as much information from the jellyfish as we could. So the jellyfish are subtle creatures, which is my catchphrase now. And basically we had a lot of ways we can extract information from them, but the most effective was through video. So basically we have a little Raspberry Pi system built here that uses a camera to follow the jellyfish. So as the jellyfish move through the aquarium, we follow their movements, and as they swim around, we gather this data. And this data is then used to actuate the robot. Here we can see the first version of the robot. In KIKK Festival, we're exhibiting a more advanced hydraulic version of the robot, which convulses and lights up depending on the jellyfish movements. Besides the robot, we also have a surround sound system, which is also actuated by this data, and the sound is actually based on the recordings Robertina did in Izmir. So that sound is used and resynthesized and modulated according to the data we gather from the jellyfish. So, yeah, this is it. Maybe I can briefly talk also about the jellyfish. There were some tries to get data from them via their resistance or directly accessing them, and this is wrong ethically also. So for our project, we want to be good guys and try to establish a nice rapport with them, and also we found this was the best way to gather this data. So yeah. Thank you.
Just a sec. Yeah. So as the project was continuing, and when we had been with Slavko working on the project, there was also lots of other people which they could be involved into it. Because especially in this kind of art science collaborative works, you can't work alone. At least I'm not able to, and I'm always kind of inviting then all the people which they have this exactly the knowledge which I need, or we need to continue with the project and develop it. So this is my shout out to all the amazing people which I had this privilege also to work with. I had luck to have consultancy also from Dr. Alenka Malay from Slovenia's marine station. She is one of the main scientists working more than 40 years on jellyfish, like plankton. So it was really great to have her knowledge also involved into our project further. The second part of the project, Aurelia One Plus Hertz, there we wanted to go more into this kind of question, what is this animal there, you know, who is it, what is our relationship with it, you know, also if I speak in keywords, it's about this kind of interspecies relationship, communication, and how to develop that, how to see, how to navigate that kind of stuff. So what we developed then, because I'm saying we, because Slavko was also still involved in that part of the project also, we decided to work more with the sound and to help to build the immersion in the space. So first I will play you a little video from that, so you will get idea what I'm talking about, and then I will explain it a bit more into data. So, whoops, I need to put it to silent, I want to leave it a bit to be with me in the sound also. So if you see the performance, the audiovisual performance happens like this, you know, the public comes into the space, me and Jellyfish, we are already on the stage, the video is just more than helping the immersion, and the sound is the main navigator, I would say, in the space. So when the half of the sound is controlled through algorithm which was programmed by my collaborator Slavko, and the other part of the sound is navigated by me. All is from this kind of archive recordings which we had from them, and it's kind of merging together. On the end of performance, I disappear from the stage and only Jellyfish stay there. And I like to use quote from Paul Celan for this project, which is saying there is still songs to sing beyond mankind. And what I would like to say with that is that, you know, we think that we are very privileged, that communication is only our way of talking, but I think that we are very wrong. The sound, and also in general, in different sensory perceptions, many of them we even don't understand, is used by many different species, also in deep sea. And how they navigate and how to control that, it's very unknown to us as we are unknown to them. And here I was looking for this kind of correlation between us and them also. As curiosity, just like the inner system. Okay, just close this. So the inner system from jellyfish, this is this sensor for X, Y, and Z is kind of helping them to navigate the gravity. It's very similar like our inner ear. It has the same crystal and so on. So it's still kind of unknown, you know? Do they know? Do they even hear? They don't hear, you know? We don't know, because we don't know how to measure that. But what I want to say also is many times like this, you know? Many times we, as I mentioned before, we try to push our perception on something. And this is maybe not always the way to do it. So also with this project, there was lots of people involved. Also Nick Bureau, which is just having a talk in at KIKK Festival, just in another theater, just in right in this moment. So it was quite funny coincidence, I think, also that somebody who I'm collaborating so much, we are just at the same time synchronized, having this opportunity to speak about our perception on the species and beyond to different publics. So I'm curious how it will be that. So as I was saying before, I mentioned a few times sound, and sound is one of the important parts, I think, at least for me, when I'm exploring or researching these kind of areas, which they're quite unknown to me. So being next to the sea, doing lots of field recordings with hydrophones, which I'm building, and I'm also using lots of the professional equipment, I started to develop a project, Aquatocene, Subaquatic Quest for Serenity, which is kind of quest for serenity because of this fact. You know, when you go to the seaside and you're next to the shores and you kind of listen to the waves and it starts to be very romantic or something, and then you put the hydrophone in and then you hear everything. You know, you hear the glitter from really far, you hear, you know, all the fractions, also lots of animals, of course. So in the beginning, I was trying to record lots of this kind of bioacoustic sound, you know, to listen to animals and so on, and I started to delete kind of all these sounds, which they have been interfering my recordings on the beginning, but then I realized that I should embrace that because that's the reality, you know, it's kind of like going to the forest and trying to ignore the airplanes. It's impossible. So also in the seas and oceans is happening this, it's very present. So this project, Aquatocene, is actually talking because, you know, about this, and also the sea is very dark area, you know. The only first 200 meters are really light, you know, so there the animals can navigate with eyes, like with visual perception, and then further down it's mostly just orientation through the sound or through different sensory perception, which is not kind of used to us, you know. And Pascal Quinard's book is really amazing book about the music and also the hatred of the music, all these kind of different relationships. And as he's saying, there is no eyelids for our ears, you know, because, you know, for eyes we can always shut them down, you know, but for the sound it's really impossible to unplug just like that, especially if you're animal, which is just being there because of our presence and not vice versa. And then with this kind of research of invisible, you know, and trying to make it visible, I continued this year together with colleague Gino Šutić from Croatia. And we had residency at Ars Electronica and also at UR Institute in Dubrovnik in Adriatic Sea. And with this research, we went a bit further. We have been kind of looking into possibilities and to navigate to find these kind of pharmaceuticals, chemical pollutants, which they are very present, especially on the shores. And during this research, we have been doing lots of sampling of the waters and so on. Plus, we did also lots of in vitro experiments. And this, what you have see here, it's like desintegration, this means dying, of microorganisms in different solutions of pharmaceuticals, which we are intaking on everyday basis. And I will just play on a short documentary video about this project, so you will get better insight. It was quite, it's a research which we started this summer and we plan to continue also further on in next years.
Underwater interception of biotweaking in Aquatocene by Robertina Šebjanič and Gino Šutić.
Oops.
Aquaforensic illuminates the invisible anthropogenic pharmaceutical chemical pollutants,
sorry,
residues of human consumption, monsters in the waters. The project combines art, science, citizen science in a hunt for a phantom, and opens the discussion about our solidarity and empathy with waters beyond human perception. These invisible chemical pollutants, such as legal and illegal drugs, mood controllers, antibiotics, antimycotics, painkillers, hormone pills, and so forth, are the residue of human consumptions discharged into underwater habitats that were explored during a residency at Ars Electronica in the summer of 2018 in two specific localities: the Danube River, Linz, Austria, and Adriatic Sea, Dubrovnik, Croatia. The project goal is to make these invisible anthropogenic pollutants and the pattern of their effects in the water habitats visible. With samplings of water and the seabed, we are hunting for a phantom of our presence in the context of new mythologies. With pollution, we change the oceans inside out, influencing life and behavior of the whole cybernetic loop of the interconnected ecosystem. The vast complexity of the ecosystem that covers more than 70% of the planet, producing over 80% of the atmospheric oxygen, is still mysterious. We are opening discussions about aquaforming and pushing the question of the human footprint on water to make it as present as the terraforming in the deep age of the Anthropocene. Anthropogenic presence is now aquaforming every part of the water habitats. It is the result of our global socio-technological system and its geopolitical, social, economic interest in water, from the shallow waters on the coastal lines to the deepest points in the oceans. By conducting citizen science investigation on forensic oceanography, we are looking into hidden secrets. The combination of science, art, and field research is opening new doors in developing sustainable solutions. Bringing these problems and thus development closer to citizens. There are a lot of challenges, but also potentials when working with this topic and prototyping tools for water exploration. The major omnipresent invisible anthropogenic pollutants are the semi-consumed pharmaceuticals that stay overlooked and are changing not just us, but also the life in fresh and saltwater habitats all around the globe. The human body, on average, is able to digest only 20% of the drugs that we consume, while the other 80% is disposed from our body to waste systems, ending up in the world's waters. This has a malignant impact on the whole interconnected ecosystem in an escalating loop pattern. The loop is similar to the food consumption chain, which is entering a never-ending circle of multiple effects on such things as the development patterns of all living organisms. From the micro level, viruses, bacteria, and other microorganisms, to the largest organisms in the oceans. Aquaforensic. It's a voyage into the relationship between the microbial seas and humans who are aquaforming the water habitats all around the planet. The question is, how do the oceans feel our impact?
So with the project Aquatocene, we approached a topic which was quite unknown. Also, I was more curious about it than I knew about it when I started to work on it. The impact which we have with our presence on daily lives, especially in this kind of intaking of pharmaceuticals, is enormous. The data which we came across was quite alarming, I would say. which and what we try to do with the project is, because you know, I know that instead of this kind of more ecological awareness of understanding what is happening, the oceans, they start to be the topic, which I think is very important. We are kind of aware plastics is bad for us, you know, so we're kind of getting there, you know, also on different regulations, also on the political levels, not only on citizen levels, which I think that combination of both fields should be working even more intense together to change these kind of situations. What I try to work on with my projects, it's, doesn't want to go bigger, doesn't matter. It's just like to try to understand also the other creatures and the other living, not just in the sense that we will build something for them, but also how to navigate this kind of life together. And this is what I prepared for today. I hope you enjoy also our installation. It's in the gallery, which I'm really bad in pronouncing the name, so I will prefer not to even try it, but it's just here on the corner. It's next to other amazing artists like Lutz Moreau and so on from France and all around the world, which we are showing different next to our Aurelia. There's a jellyfish project, which was presented on the beginning of this talk. There's also some interesting projects about the bees and behavior, and there's all ecosystemic situation happening. So for me as artist working in this field is also, I think, very enjoyable to see to be placed together with other people which they are thinking this way. Thank you.